This is the first of several videos about exponentials of matrices. So in this video, we're going to talk about the preliminaries, and we'll actually get to the definition of the exponential of a matrix in the next video. So our goal is to make sense of the expression e to a matrix times t. That's as a function of time, where A is some square matrix. And while we're at it, we're also going to make sense of e to a complex number times t. And, you know, the first time I saw these concepts, I was floored. It just didn't make any sense to me, because I knew exponentials in a pretty naive sense, as something multiplied by itself a bunch of times. And if I write e to the a, that's not e times e times e a matrix number of times. A matrix number of times doesn't make sense. And if I write e to the 3 plus 2i, that's not e times e times e 3 plus 2i times. You can't multiply things together 2i times. But if you think about it, you can't multiply things by each other square root of 7 times either. And if we've been dealing with functions like e to the x, where you take e to an arbitrary real number power, including e to the root 7, and that can't be understood in these naive terms either. So we're going to have to expand our focus, and we'll get a way of understanding this, and then this, and then this. But we're going to start at the very beginning with the most naive definition of an exponential. So if you have a positive integer, then you know what e to the a means. E to the a means you multiply e by itself a bunch of times. And so, for example, if you had e cubed times e squared, well, e cubed is e times e times e, and e squared is e times e. And if you multiply them together, now you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 factors of e. So this is e to the 3 plus 2. And in general, we have the rule that e to the a plus b is e to the a plus e to the b. And that's a really good rule. It's really useful. And it makes perfect sense if a and b are positive integers, because all you're doing is you're counting factors. And likewise, if you take e cubed squared, well, that's e cubed times e cubed. So you've got three factors of e twice. So that gives you 3 times 2 factors of e. Makes perfect sense. So we had this rule that e to the a to the b is e to the ab. And we said, yeah, that's a good rule too. We want to keep that one. And this makes great sense as long as a and b are positive integers. But what if we want a negative integer? What if we want something that isn't an integer at all? To deal with that, we expand our definitions. We come up with new rules that, when you happen to apply them to positive integers, give us the old rules. And when you apply them to other numbers, they still work, and our rules still apply. So the first rule we're going to have is we're going to define e to the 0 isn't 1. You know, this isn't written on stone tablets handed down from heaven. It's a definition we choose to make. E to the 0 is 1, and we discover that our rules still work. Because if you take e to the 0 times e to the a, well, that's 1 times e to the a, and that's e to the a, and that's e to the 0 plus a. So it all makes sense. This is an extension of our rules that's consistent with all of the old definition. And the next thing is we define negative powers. We say e to the minus a, we'll define that to be 1 over e to the a. And we still have everything working nicely, because e to the a times e to the minus a, well, that's e to the a over e to the a, and that's 1. That's e to the 0. And 0 is the same thing as a minus a. So the rule that e to the a times e to the b is e to the a plus b, it works even when a or b might be negative. And then we define fractional powers. We want e to the 1 half to be square root of e. Well, it's not multiplying e by itself half a time, but we want e to the 1 half times e to the 1 half to be e to the 1 half plus a half, in other words, e. So the only way to make that work is to make e to the 1 half be root e. So we define e to a positive rational number, e to the p over q, is just e to the p, that's e times e times e, p times, qth root. And then we define e to a negative rational number as just being 1 over that. So now we've defined e to any rational number. We still haven't defined e to an irrational number. And to do that, we need calculus. And there are a couple of approaches. The approach I like best is to think in terms of a differential equation. We're going to look at the function e to the t and say f of t is e to the t is the unique function whose derivative is the original function and whose value at 0 is 1. Okay? And an alternate definition is with a power series. And how do you know that they're equivalent? Well, if you plug in 0 into the power series, you get 1 plus 0 plus 0 squared plus 0 cubed. That's 1. That works. And if you take the derivative of the power series, derivative of t is 1, derivative of t squared over 2 is t, derivative of t cubed over 6 is t squared over 3, and so on. So this definition, this function given by this power series, satisfies these two conditions, so the two definitions are equivalent. So you have to do some work to show that this agrees with the old definition when t is rational, but now we've got a definition that works even when t is irrational. Now let's take it one step further. Let's define the function e to the at. To get e to the at, we want a function whose derivative is a times f of t, and whose value at 0 is 1. It's pretty easy to check that the derivative of e to the at is a times e to the at, and e to the 0 is 1. You could also get it with a power series. If you like power series better than differential equations, you can use the power series. And you can see that this satisfies the differential equations just by plugging it in. Okay. Either way, if you want to understand what e to the a is from this, you just take t equals 1, and it's e to the at at t equals 1. Wonderful. Except now we can do the same thing for complex numbers. If you want to make sense of e to the it, the calculus definition works just fine. That's going to be a function whose derivative is I times f of t, is I times itself, and whose value at 0 is 1. And here is such a function. Its derivative, the derivative of cosine t plus I sine t, is minus sine plus I cosine. Derivative of cosine is minus sine. Derivative of sine is cosine. And that's I times cosine plus I sine. I cosine, I times I is negative 1, gives you negative sine. And f of 0, cosine of 0 plus I sine of 0 is 1 plus I times 0, which is 1. So it works. We have Euler's formula, e to the it is cosine of t plus I sine of t. And in general, we could have gotten the same result from the Taylor series. If you write out the Taylor series with an it in there, if you expand it out, you have a bunch of i's in all the odd terms, and you discover that the real part is just the Taylor series for cosine, and the imaginary part is the Taylor series for sine, and then you get cosine plus I sine. Okay, so what does that mean? Now we're able to define exponentials of any complex number, not just it, but a plus bi times t. So if z is a plus bi, we define e to the zt is going to be a function whose derivative is z times the original function, whose value at 0 is 1. And I claim that this function does the trick. E to the at times the e to the bit, or e to the at times cosine of bt plus I sine of bt. You can check. It satisfies the differential equation. Or if you plug in t equals 1, you get that e to the a plus bi is e to the a times e to the bi. And e to the bi is cosine of b plus I sine of b. And the picture of this is pretty straightforward. You draw the complex plane with the real axis and the imaginary axis. And you get a number, complex number, whose magnitude is e to the a, and whose argument is b. And if you have the function e to the at, then you have something whose magnitude is e to, so if you have e to the zt, you have something whose magnitude grows exponentially, and whose argument goes around and around and around and around with rate t. So now we've done exponentials of real numbers, complex numbers. Next time we'll do exponentials of matrices.